Disney's Amphibious series was a lot better than a kids' show needed to be. While checking off all the boxes necessary to be quote-unquote made for kids, there was still a lot of mature themes that can appeal to adults, dark themes, especially involving racism, manipulation, and coping with traumatic events. And even watching it a second time around, it was still good fun. Unlike most shows which hold people over with anticipation and, oh, what happens next, Amphibious still has everything else going for it. A good sense of humor, excellent voice acting, characters who stayed true to their traits and didn't bend or wilt just to move the plot forward, unlike a lot of other shows that force the characters to become something they're not just to keep things moving on. Before you get mad at me over throwing shade at that beloved series, understand, I enjoy The Owl House. There's just a lot more issues with that show's storytelling than in most cartoons, which made my second time around watching it far more difficult than the first, which is something that wasn't an issue with Amphibia, even on the serialized episodes. I feel as though the characters and their interactions made Owl House what it is, and that can be said about Amphibia as well. But while I was deconstructing each character in Amphibia for this tier list, I realized there is very little to most of them, and just goes to show that an amazing show can still be made with half-baked, shallow characters. And when the word Amphibia comes to mind, I don't think of the iconic roles, but the overarching plot, which is what made me enjoy the show so much. An Amphibia character tier list is a video I've wanted to make ever since I watched the show, and I already have a tier list on She-Ra. I'll put a reminder at the end of the screen if you're interested, and if you want to see more Owl House Amphibian She-Ra content, subscribe because I'm working on a massive Amphibia parody in addition to my little brother's Owl House Abridged, and the finale of my She-Ra parody, which basically birthed my channel. Now, I'm going to assume that if you've watched this far, you probably actually care what my opinions on each of these characters are, and I'll be starting off with the Plantar family.
Yo, you're now tuned in to Jaleel Live. Are you energized?
Sorry guys, no good news to report.
Anne, the one and only Anne, victim of Admiral Daryl or whatever his name was. Anne was very much a dingus in season 1. I believe the constant life and death scenarios really changed her perspective on life within the show because she's a totally new person in season 2 who shows responsible character traits. The change is so gradual throughout season 1 that I don't think the audience realizes it until Anne's parents shove it down our throats in season 3 how much of a difference there has been. But that attribute makes me like her a lot, showing growth, realized potential, and over a long stretch of time rather than all that once like literally every character in She-Ra. The emotional storyline of season 3 between Anne and her parents was very relatable, but other than that, I don't see much as far as Anne just being an enjoyable, fun character with high intensity, but not scary intensity like with Sasha. But the intensity that this character just makes every scenario she's in more fun. Easy A tier. If the emotional storyline for Anne was deeper in season 1 and 2, something more than fear of the unknown new world, I would put her up to S, but that's quite a step higher from Hop Hop.
So do you have a boyfriend back home? Ow!
Papadiah was a really ageist character whose humor usually relied on gross and deprecating things that removed the audience's respect for him. As far as serving the plot, he serves as the caretaker role for Anne, helping to keep her out of trouble. I thought Papadiah was really enjoyable because I can vibe with that gross and weird humor, but overall kinda trash as I think that rubs a lot of people the wrong way. And he is very rarely talked about in the community. I think the writers wrote him to be obnoxious on purpose, and if that's what their aim was, they did perfectly because I haven't seen a single person admit to liking this character. His effective role as caretaker for Anne is the only thing keeping him from F. E tier.
Ooh, exciting! I guess I'd better get an item for Ivy.
Since we are an item.
Sprig. You could remove Sprig from the show and 99% of it would be the same. I get he's supposed to be the even younger than Anne child for 8-year-olds to identify with on screen, but the issue is, Sprig is just annoying. If not more so than actual 8-year-olds, which makes me dislike him strongly. He affects the plot so little unless the spotlight is getting dedicated to him. But even then, Sprig gets the spotlight and time to shine more often than Papadiah and still fails to become a fully utilized character in the show. I don't find him funny or cute at all. He hardly helps the storyline and the emotional notes about friendships and parental love that are brought up are so brief it doesn't even grow his character. C Season 3 Sprig just knows when to not spaz out, which is a matter of self-control, which if he hadn't learned those lessons, he would be even more insufferable than in Season 1. Season 1 Sprig is the worst, and Sprig is F-tier for failure to reach potential.
Thank you!
Polly, the even younger self-identification for the 5-year-olds watching this show, because Disney primarily targets the age range of 8 to 12 with their cartoons. Polly is somewhat an odd inclusion, because I can't think of the last cartoon I watched that had virtually a baby character. She doesn't really help the plot move in any meaningful way like Hopadiah at least did, teaching Anne allegories and being their protector. Polly caused an insane amount of mischief, so far as emotional storylines go, Polly was a vehicle for a lot of Anne's personal growth, especially in Season 1, as Anne learned how and why to look after people other than herself. I don't necessarily find her more funny than Sprig, but I definitely find her far less annoying, which is why I place her in E tier. E for she's an extra.
I am General Yunnan, scourge of the Sand Wars, defeater of Ragnar the Wretched, the youngest new to ever achieve the rank of general in the great Newtopian army!
Yunnan, hands down, the most badass character in this show. I get the vibe she made a lot of people watching question their orientation. Like, am I attracted to this alpha female energy? If she wasn't so masculine, maybe I wouldn't care. Jokes aside, Yunnan's over-the-top performance pieces are non-self-aware bits that make her hilarious without taking away the seriousness of the situation, like comedic relief without diffusing tension. I've never noticed any character playing a role like that in anything else I've watched before, so this is honestly really cool and unique. She has relatively little effect on what goes on around her, so she's not utilized as well as she could have been by the writers. Like, at the end of the day, she's another extra, but she's enjoyable to have on screen and has to fight through the feelings of betraying the throne she's dedicated her life to, cutting off a toxic obsession to conquests and glory in order to prioritize life above carnage. This 180 is glanced over by the show, but I feel it matters a whole lot when trying to draw real-life experiences from cartoons. An unexpected scenario or betrayal that forces you to rethink your stances on life. I feel Yunnan does that very well. If she had more effect on the plot, I could give her S tier, but the pure fun she brings to the screen and the separate emotional storyline we could dive into makes Yunnan an easy A.
What about you two? Are you with me?
We're with you.
Definitely with you.
Olivia. This character was nothing more than a prop, royalty to be royalty in this show to give the protagonist somebody on the inside to help out. Olivia's existence is a writing trope and it's lame. That's not the end of her lameness, she's not funny, but at the same time she doesn't try to be, so it would be unfair to judge her the same way we judge Yunnan or Sprig. I feel like Olivia is extremely mid. There's very little emotional development here. She turns on Andreas the moment she could without any real strong reason to join or object to him. It felt very random and putting her on the high horse for the sake of having somebody there. I can't think of any real flaws of Olivia's characters besides the fact that she's hardly a character. She has a posh royal personality and that's pretty much it. F tier, nothing special whatsoever.
These are the valley's strongest warriors. Pathetic!
Grimes, I'm happy to announce the first S-tier character. Not only did this character get hyped up as a major boss fight, he fell from grace. A high-ranking governing position to fugitive wasting away in a cabin. Standing down one of the most feared warriors, Yunnan, if we're taking her seriously that is, and then playing a major role in overthrowing a kingdom, Grimes has his ups and downs, he learns from them, the audience can see where he came from, and I think that's why I haven't heard a single person crap on Grimes as a character, because everybody was able to empathize with him despite starting out as a villain. He played the menacing villain role, then he played a hero, then he played a villain again, and once more a hero. It never felt clunky the entire time, and to be honest, he was like Yunnan in the sense of his level of seriousness was funny to an extent, but he also had his own sense of humor that separates him from the rest. He's the kind of guy that would laugh at 4chan memes. Grimes is easily one of the best fictional characters I've ever seen just because of how naturally his character flows and in a way that pushes and benefits the plot. The writers didn't have to force him to do out-of-character stunts just to make the show end the way they wanted it to. And all the while, it was interesting to watch him fully arc out.
Hey, what's up, Sash?
Oh, I'll tell you what's up. You're sitting here binge-watching trash TV all day when we're supposed to be training.
Sasha! One thing I didn't like about her character was from the start, we all knew she played some sort of villainess role. We were all just upset that Anne couldn't see it. I feel like this was more of a prop personality trait than Sasha's own character development because abuse and manipulation have become so commonplace in children's media recently that creating a character for that express purpose actually feels old already. The good part is, Sasha grew out of that and became her own character from the ashes of an antagonist. She gained her own ambitions, and while for absolutely dumb reasons, it provided great entertainment and teeth-clenching tension wondering when the penny would drop. However, she was unlikable for so long that while excelling in driving the plot forward, which was the purpose of her existence in the first two seasons, she lacks in every other area during season 1 and 2, barely funny, if anything, mean funny, like your friends who can't make a joke without insulting you kind of funny. Her personality was atrocious, somebody I would not want to be stuck in an elevator with. However, in season 3, she really came into her own and really arced out, though developed too late in my opinion because we hardly see her in the first half of season 3 and then the other half is just fighting. The majority of that character development and lesson learning happened off screen or in the few episodes surrounding when Anne returned to Amphibia. That lack of screen time hugely diminishes the value of her contribution to the storyline because it takes the interesting stuff away and turns it into exposition. Honestly, I really liked Sasha as a character and felt there was so much more that could have been done with her. I didn't realize until writing the script how one-note she was. She was at least interesting on screen, so F would be undeserved, so I'll just say E.
Alright, this should be the final room.
Marcy. I feel like Marcy is the most popular character because autism representation, and overall just being fun and smart. However, by the time we meet her in the show, she's done as much character development as she's going to get, which makes all of her emotional storylines next to meaningless because they were already explored before they reunited in season 2. The ending happened so fast in season 2, it's like she didn't even get to learn from her mistakes, and then most of season 3, she was a cyborg puppet of the core instead of being herself. For a character that had like half a season worth of actual screen time and stuff, people stan this character hard, and if it's not for the reasons I already mentioned, I can't get behind it. She's not really a funny character other than the things she does are supposed to be funny, however it's always felt incredibly forced while watching it. Like Mr. Peanut Butter and BoJack, not funny at all, while the writers try desperately to make him so, unless the joke was that he's just super annoying. If it wasn't for Marcy, the plot of the show never would have happened, so I can't deny that effect and wish we could have seen more of her. And I know I put Sasha and E and Sprig and F, but I feel Marcy belongs right between them, so I'm putting Marcy in E and moving Sasha up to C. Just because Sasha ended up mattering far more in regards to how episodes played out, and Marcy's contributions to the plot are overstated by the community.
Hello!
Andreas. I'm sorry, but I saw somebody on Twitter saying something like, if you liked Andreas, then you're some racist bigot who needs to KYS, and I never understood why any people ever thought fandoms ever were toxic, but that tweet opened my eyes because it was so brain dead that for a moment I didn't want to be a part of the Amphibia community whatsoever. But eventually the shock of stupidity wore off and I was able to reevaluate those thoughts and understand where fandom haters come from. Aside from garbage Twitter takes, Andreas' emotional journey in this series happened too fast, in which I mean, the dude was literally handed a piece of paper and he's suddenly a changed man. The aspects of Anne's personal growth that I loved was that it happened gradually, and as far as Grimes goes, he never needed to be on one side or the other in order to push the plot forward. If Andreas was still cold-hearted even after reading the letter, then that would just mean he's experienced absolutely no character growth. However, him sticking to his morals and decisions whether or not he feels that way would have made a much more interesting finale than him giving up, and it definitely would have made a more interesting aftermath if, at the end of the day, he wasn't actually a nice guy being manipulated. Showing that Andreas is under control of the Core takes almost all agency out of his actions, and he just becomes an extension of the show's evil incarnate. Andreas as a character was just as much of a puppet of the Core as Darcy, and that makes him not matter as an individual. He's not funny, and it's not even his fault the plot was going like this, because it's just the Core forcing him to. And then his emotional growth is shallow at best. He gets an F.
Where have you been? Are you okay? Are you hurt? Have you eaten? Your hair's a mess.
It's a really, really long story.
Ms. Boon Choi, MILF. 10 out of 10. A tier. Probably makes a fantastic cherry pie, no pun intended. Mr. Boon Choi. Probably makes puns. He's actually portrayed as a cool dad in this show, and I like that difference from typical hard-ass or soft-ass dads like Infinity Train and Johnny Test. I know those are the weirdest shows to compare it to, but they were the first things that pop into my head.
Okay, class, everyone thank Anne the herpetologist.
Thanks, Frog Lady.
Basically, the characters in Amphibia are shit. I love the storyline and writing, though. Maybe my standards for a good character are too much. In fact, this is how I graded them. I start them off at C, then I move them up or down depending on these three traits: funny, plot relevant, and emotional storyline. Most of the characters in this show weren't funny, they were just annoying. A disproportionately large chunk of the main cast hardly had an impact on the plot, and even more told nothing with their internal journey. Go check out my She-Ra tier list. I didn't use this criteria there, but instead thought methodically about each character as an individual, which made Bo a very high rank. Honestly, even if I did apply all the same criteria to Bo, he would still stand just as high as he does.